Hi, I'm Kelly. I'm going to try and make this intro kind of short because I have a lot to say in this video, and I've noticed that when I start to make the intro, I get a little bit nervous and caught off guard and start acting a little robotic. But nonetheless, here is just a little rundown. This video is part of a video series that I've been creating about my experience with keratoconus and its treatment options. This video in particular is going to be about my experience with keratoconus. I did this in the last take. Anyway, keratoconus and my academic life. And that includes the challenges that keratoconus has brought to my schoolwork and the strategies that I've used to overcome those challenges. I hope that these strategies help you maybe brainstorm some ideas of how you might be able to apply this to your own personal experience and the challenges that you are personally facing in your academic life. So, to get started, I mentioned previously that I wanted to think through some ideas. I didn't want to go too in depth with my thinking because I knew that it would be too scripted and not really relatable. So, I've bullet pointed some ideas. And I'm going to take you through my journey from high school, like the end of high school, to my current status as a graduate student. So hopefully that will give you a variety of ideas and, a variety of levels of education. And also it will provide you with an idea of how to maybe handle the situation on campus as well as online. So, to give you the best idea of my personal experience, I want to be transparent with you and let you know that I'm not perfect. I'm not a perfect student. In my academic life, I have had fluctuation in my grades. It usually begins, for me, I've had trouble in my academic career at the beginning of a new transition. So in high school, I had trouble adjusting to high school and did well, didn't do well the first couple years, but did pretty well the last couple years, and the same thing went for college. So that is in part due to my ADD, and I'm kind of curious. I don't think there's many studies done on ADD and keratoconus. But there might be studies done on ADD and the visually impaired. I mean, blind. So it looks like there's some information on students with ADD and being blind. That's kind of one of the things with keratoconus is since it's kind of a rare condition, there's less studies done for that than there are for people who are completely blind. So if you try to search resources rather, sorry, for keratoconus with schoolwork, it often brings you to information about resources for blind students. Even though technically for a while I was legally blind. So, I will start with high school. Sorry if this is going to be a little bit all over the place. I'm just kind of trying to think of my experiences and let you know as I'm making this video and as they come to mind. So it might be a little scattered. So I apologize for that. So, in high school, I was unaware that I had keratoconus. I believe I knew I had keratoconus at the end of high school or at the very beginning of my college life. So, in high school, I didn't know that I had keratoconus, but I did know I had ADD, and at my high school, there was a program called Language Support, and it was for students that had learning disabilities. And I'm not sure if It would have been accessible for someone who had a physical disability like keratoconus, but I do know that one of my classmates did have a visual impairment and they made the accommodations for him. So I know that every school is different with the resources they provide, but I know that in my high school there were some ways of students getting resources if they had a physical disability like keratoconus. College, though, this I think college life and grad school life is really important, especially with keratoconus, because to discuss at least, because this is the first time where you're really off on your own and you're having to traverse this journey by yourself and stay on task as well as be able to handle the challenges that keratoconus is bringing. So I, in college, again, I struggled the first year, and that was mainly just because I had to get adjusted to the new environment and being responsible for my own actions and getting to class and doing the assignments appropriately. But in college, I made sure to sit in the front of the class for the most part. There were only a few classes that I sat towards the back, and mostly when I sat towards the back, it was just because I didn't want to be called on. And I think that's kind of a common thing for students to do, but I would say it definitely is helpful to sit towards the front. Another thing that is helpful is to bring an audio recorder or some sort of app on your computer if electronics are allowed, and record the lecture on that while you're taking notes so later on you would be able to listen to the lecture and retain the information a little bit better by listening to it. So yeah, one of the apps that I use was called audiobook. Yes, audiobook. And that basically is an audio recorder on a computer app that also has a notepad attached to it so you can type notes while you're recording the lecture. I will say, and again, everyone's experience is unique, so I know not everyone has ADD, but if you are someone who has ADD, just be wary of using an audio recorder because I think sometimes it makes you feel like you have a security net and it causes you to zone out and not pay attention because you're like, oh, it's already covered. I've got it in my audio recorder. I definitely did that. I definitely would put on my audio recorder and then like start watching Pacers games in the middle of class. So I did well in the class that I did that in. It was a late night class, so, but nonetheless, don't do that. It's not really a smart idea. So let's see here. Class seating, I've discussed that. I would say sit in the front. That is probably the best idea because it's easier to see. As far as class seating, taking notes and seeing the board, one of the most difficult things that I realized through the whole process is it seems like the teacher goes so fast and I'm unable to take notes. Maybe that is just due to my poor writing, or maybe it's due to the fact that I'm not super fast at typing on the computer, but I found it difficult to take concise notes or notes that took in all of the information that I needed from the lecture, which again is a good reason why you might want to record some of the lectures. So, class seating, making teachers aware. Yeah, that one is definitely something that I should go over. So, in college, I was kind of an idiot, and I mean, I understand the reason why I did it, and I'm kind of proud of the fact that I did this, but at the same time, I don't recommend doing this. So, in my art classes, I didn't tell my professors that I had a visual impairment until it was like detrimental that I told them. And this was at my college, there's this thing called sophomore review. I did it when I was a junior because I had switched majors. But it's basically because we don't have to submit a portfolio of artwork in order to get into the art program. But after a year, you have to take off the work that you've done in the department and then present it in front of all of the heads of the department. And they judge whether or not, sorry, you can stay in the department or if you have to try again to pass the sophomore review or move on. So I didn't tell any of my teachers because I wanted to be, I wanted to be happy with the decision I was making, and I didn't want to feel like I was getting by only due to the disability that I have. So I didn't want to use my keratoconus as a crutch. I didn't want them to be like, oh, her artwork isn't that great, but she has a visual impairment. I wanted honest feedback, and I don't think I would have gotten that had I not, had I told them that I had keratoconus. That being said, I don't recommend that you do this because your teachers are there to help you, and if you need resources from them, you should make it aware from the forefront that you have this disability because otherwise, if you don't tell them, you might struggle and you might regret not having the help. Or if you don't tell them and then tell them later, they might not believe you. I mean, that's kind of an unlikely situation, but they might be like, oh, well, you didn't tell me, this early on. So I would definitely recommend that you tell your teachers and make them aware because they would be vital resources to you in the future. So let them know. Let's see here. Yes. Okay. So speaking of calling upon help, I would say one of the important things is don't feel like you have to go through this alone. There are probably plenty of resources available, and that doesn't just mean like academic resources. That means your friends, your family, your teacher. So definitely make use of the vital resources that you have. Friends, maybe they can lend you their notes. Maybe they can record a lecture for you. Sorry, my computer started zoning out here. So maybe they can. I'm just making sure this won't cut out on me again. So maybe they can help you record a lecture or take notes. I don't know. If you have amazing friends, maybe they can read a book and record it for you so you can listen to them read a book instead of trying to strain your eyes to read it on the page. Your friends and your family can be really vital resources, as well as teachers. Let them know. Maybe they can scan and print a larger version of a book for you. Maybe they can record the lecture for you. Just know that people are probably going to be willing to help you. And this, I want to get into some of my experiences just to give you an idea of what to do and what not to do and just some of the experiences I went through. So, as I said, I tried to be really strong with this impairment and not really tell anyone, not really ask for a bunch of help. And I think that's kind of characteristic for someone with a visual impairment. Don't mind me, I'm going to get a little bit psychological in this video. It's what I'm studying, so it's going to kind of become a little bit more incorporated as I make these videos. But I think it's kind of a common thing for people with visual impairments to not want to ask for help because in our life, we have so little control over what we do for the most part that we take things and want to have like total control over them. So I feel like I wanted to have total control over my academic life and not really ask for help because I felt like maybe that was giving up control. And just like today I study super hard and I work really hard on the projects that I have because I feel like it's one of the things in my life that I currently have the most control over. I don't know if I already said that. I may have. But I feel like it's something in my life that I have the most control over. No, I can't control the direct outcome of the grade. You know, maybe a teacher grades differently. I can't say, oh, I want a 100 and then get a 100. But I know I can control the amount of effort I put in. So use your resources, but I'll give you a couple examples of really it's kind of the same thing, but I had a class. Oh, that's done, and now we'll get back to this. I was talking about a class where I had to call upon the help of others, my dad and my teacher. So, I took this class in college called 3D Design. If you don't know, I was an art major with a sculpture concentration. 3D Design was a required course for anyone who was going to be in an art major or a minor. So, this was a different story from sculpture. I love 3D objects and I love to create them, but this was a very different experience because it required very minute details and very exact, precise cuts. So it was very difficult for me not being able to see to make exactly the correct measurements and cut exactly the right way. Because if your X-Acto knife just, well, let me explain. I had to build a lot of 3D models out of cardboard and with interlocking pieces and all of that. So if your knife, if your X-Acto knife were to tilt on the cardboard, that would throw off the entire piece. Any small mistake you would make would show up in the final product. So I was having a terrible time with these projects. I asked my dad to help me cut out some of the pieces. Clearly he didn't do the design for me and he couldn't complete the whole thing for me, but the larger pieces he helped me cut out because I was having trouble seeing the knife cuts. So that I asked my dad for help with that, and then also my teacher just noticed as I was walking past his office, and my teacher was amazing. He was my advisor. He was my academic advisor and the head of the department. So he definitely taught me a lot and definitely made sure that I was taken care of. But I was walking past his office and I was having a tough year as it was, aside from just the keratoconus too. So he was like, "You look like you're either going to break down crying or explode." And I said, "Well, I'm not really one to explode, but break down I might." So he talked to me and let me know that he was there for me and if I needed any help to let him know, and then that I shouldn't worry too much because I was doing really well in sculpture. So he was really good at encouraging me, talking me down from this heightened emotion of sadness and like fear of failure. So I called upon them for help, but I, for the most part, was bad about calling on people for help. Now, in this, I think I mentioned my friends or friends helping out. I did not really try to build a huge friend base in college just because I knew that school was kind of difficult for me, so I wanted that to be my main focus. And I kind of regret that. Obviously, friends are a very important part of your life, and they certainly can be a lot of help too. I did have some friends who were very helpful and would at least keep me company in the studio if not anything else.
So definitely don't minimize your friendships in college or in school of any sort, because they definitely can be of assistance. And that's not to say to use your friends either. Obviously, it should be a mutual exchange. You should be able to help them if they need it, just as they should be able to help you if you need it. So now I'm kind of going to get into some of the strategies that might help. As I said, recording the lectures might be really helpful, but I know based on the comments that I've read of everyone's, that doesn't make much sense. Based on the comments that I've read from these videos, I know that people are pretty concerned with books and being able to read books for their classes and how difficult that is. So for physical books, it's kind of hard because if it's a textbook, it most likely isn't the most full of resources for people with visual impairments. If there is an audiobook, I would definitely recommend that you use an audiobook. But that being said, when I would use an audiobook for like literature classes, they're kind of hard to find for textbooks. But when I would use audiobooks for literature classes, what I would do is sometimes I would have a physical copy. Again, sorry, sometimes I might kind of fade off, but I'm just kind of thinking. So I would sometimes have the physical textbook and sometimes I wouldn't, but I would always have two things. I would have a copy that I could read, highlight, and annotate, and then I would have the audiobook and I would follow along with the visual, either ebook or the physical copy of the book, and annotate and highlight so I would have that for my reference. So I would not recommend that you just get purely the audiobook because it's hard to keep track, especially if you're in a class that's going to ask you to write a book on the subject. Not a book, oh my gosh, that would be terrible. Especially in a class where they're going to ask you to write a paper on it and they're going to want in-text references of what page it's on. So I would definitely recommend that you have some sort of copy that you can reference back to. And that was always my way of dealing with really long books that just took so much longer because I'm a slow reader due to the impairment. So that's my suggestion with not textbook, but for literature classes. So if you're like in an English class where you need to read a book, I would recommend having a physical copy or an ebook that you can read, highlight, and annotate. Sorry, I'm really repetitive right now. And then the audiobook for literature books because otherwise you might not be able to find it. So that's one suggestion. Another one is if you can't find the audiobook for a certain text, so maybe it's an actual textbook. A good thing that you might be able to do, and maybe there are resources that already do this for you at your school, I would definitely look into scanning in the pages that you need to read into your computer and then being able to enlarge it on your computer screen. That might be easier for you to read in order to enlarge it. And even then, maybe that's not that conducive to your eyesight either, because I know that staring at a screen for long periods of time can be very straining on the eyes and definitely can hurt and make matters worse. So, if it's an issue where you can't look at a screen for long periods of time, maybe you can scan it into your computer, enlarge it, and then print it out so you have a copy that isn't on a screen. So, let's see here. Organization. So, definitely that goes for anyone. If you aren't organized, you probably aren't going to do super well. But maybe cutting up segments of your text and, highlighting and putting in tabs and making note cards so you get the knowledge down, but you're not poring over every single word. I know that sometimes when my eyes are getting really tired, I scan the page, which a lot of people do while reading anyway, to get the basic concepts. But so taking in the information in bigger chunks rather than every minute detail might be helpful for you. So I think that's my main thing for on-campus learning. Make sure that you ask for help if you need it. Make sure you let your teachers know if there's an issue. Let your teachers know that you have a visual impairment, so you might need some resources. Ask your friends and family and teachers for help. What else here? Keep organized. Use audiobooks. Use tape recorders. And in that context, even if your class doesn't really allow electronics to be used, telling your teacher would probably allow you to use those electronics in the class that normally wouldn't allow it. So, let's see here. I think that's about it. Sit where you can see, obviously. So, that's my main tips for on-campus learning. So now, currently I am taking my online courses for my graduate school, but I also took some online classes for my undergraduate school. So I kind of want to get into that. So, I'm sorry, making weird noises because I'm thinking. I feel bad that I'm so drawn out and lengthy in this, but hopefully this is helpful. So for online learning, if you've done online learning before, or if you're planning on doing it, online learning can take many different forms. In the classes that I took for my undergraduate education, they had video lectures that I would watch. And actually, I took a supplemental class for my admission to graduate school. So I have three different resources. I have my undergraduate school, I have another place, and another place. I mean, I can tell you where it is. I undergraduate at Xavier University, and then I took a supplemental class through UC Berkeley, and then I'm at St. Mary of the Woods now. But, so for Xavier's, it was usually an online lecture. The quizzes were times, and I can't remember how long they were. I mean, it was different for every class, but you would generally see your professor in front of a camera or in a little box with the PowerPoint too, which I suppose is kind of helpful, at least to feel connected to your professor. And then you would have reading assignments, and same goes for that. I would recommend having a couple different resources and ways of strategies of overcoming the challenges that come with reading a textbook. And then in addition to that, you would have maybe a writing project and a quiz or a test, which are generally on in an online course multiple choice, but it gets more difficult sometimes. So that was one way of taking an online course. For my online course through UC Berkeley, it was very similar. Set up in modules. They were both through Canvas, so I was used to that style. And it was a reading assignment, it was a lecture, but instead of seeing the professor's face, it was just the slides. You may have been able to see him. So you had the slides, you had a transcript of the slides, which was helpful, and then you had the audio. So you had all of those different resources to use, and then you had quizzes and assignments, just like Xavier for the most part. Now in grad school, it is a little bit harder because I'm not given the lecture portion. And I'll get into more detail about that in a second. But so in grad school, I don't have the advantage, I don't have the advantage of having a lecture portion. And I have a lot of books to read, like those right there. So I don't have the lectures. I can't learn from listening to it. And I don't have, I don't know, there's not, it's not conducive to various learning styles, which I will get into in a second. So, for me, I haven't taken a test on this for a while, but I did take a quiz or test, I believe maybe once in high school and maybe once in college, to determine what learning style I have. The website I looked on to just verify that I had the learning styles down correct said there was 7. Yeah, 7 different ones, and I'm evenly split between 3 of those. Okay, pardon that interruption. If you've been watching my videos for a while, you'll probably know that my dog whines and scratches at the door to go out quite a bit. So I was talking about the 3 learning styles that I'm split between. I took the test probably in high school and I think maybe one time in college, but I'm not quite sure. So it's said that I was evenly split between 3 of the 7 learning styles, and that was oral, and not like speech oral, but like auditory. So the aura is, like, I believe is the fleshy part of your ear right here is the aura. So that's why it's called oral. So auditory, visual, and kinesthetic, which is movement and, like, physical learning, which makes sense why I like sculpture. I'm not exactly sure if everyone with keratoconus is the same, but I'll get into that in a little bit. So the other learning styles that you can have are physical. Well, I just said that. That's kinesthetic. Sorry about that. So logical, which is like mathematics and problem solving. Verbal, which is linguistics. People learn through words and language. Intrapersonal, which is people are learn through the interactions with other people. And then interpersonal is like someone who learns well by themselves and in solitude. So those are the learning styles that were listed on a website that I just checked to make sure that I had it right. So I'm split between visual, auditory, and kinesthetic. So when you take out the audio part of it, like you are in my grad school classes right now, it makes things kind of difficult because I'm relying on visual and kinesthetic learning. For me, I am able to do some kinesthetic learning in some of the projects that I have to do, but at the same time, for projects, some studying, I am not able to really use kinesthetic learning. And I'll get into that in a second, too. I'm sorry I keep you waiting, but I just want to brief over everything. So you take out that, and you are left, for me, I'm left with kinesthetic and visual. And then my vision isn't super great, so I'm relying on kind of crappy vision for a style of learning when auditory learning is absent. So it's hard for me to read books, pick up all the information, not have kinesthetic learning really, and not have auditory learning. For the project that I was telling everyone about in my quick update video was I had to read an entire textbook, Current Psychotherapies, I believe it's like 600 pages, in a month. And I didn't mean to, but I let it slip a little bit longer than it should have been because I thought it was only half of the book when I made that video, and it turned out it was the entire book. And I ended up doing okay on that quiz, but because of the strategies that I used to do well on it. I obviously worked really hard on trying to study, but there were strategies that I used to make learning it with my vision a little bit easier. So as I previously mentioned, I do have strong kinesthetic learning. So a way that I always used to figure this out in high school was if I listened to someone talk about it, and again, this is because I have the even split between the three, when I would hear someone talk about the subject or read a book or something, I would pick it up in my auditory learning. And then if I would read the notes that I took in class, that would be like another way of studying it. Hearing it, that's one time learning it. Looking at it, that's one time studying it in the book. And then I would write out my notes, even if I didn't really need to, but I would write them out because the motion would allow me to move and look at the information at the same time to kind of process it. I don't know if I wrote them out twice or something one time. I did something really weird. But that's the way that I started out with this project, was I started taking handwritten notes, and actually they're in front of me now. So I started taking handwritten notes upon notes upon notes, and it was a pain in the butt, if I'm being honest. And the problem with that was it took me so incredibly long because I was trying to read the tiny writing. In fact, maybe I'll go and get my book so I can show you the size of the text. So it's pretty tiny. It's not minuscule, but it's pretty tiny. And I had to read this entire thing. So the problem with that was it was taking me so long to read the tiny writing, and then my writing is pretty tiny, and trying to make it look nice takes me a little bit of time. So that just took forever. Another issue was it started hurting my wrist so bad, and I'm still suffering the consequences of taking all of those handwritten notes. So I began typing up my notes, which is just as effective for some people, but I think that the movement of writing my notes helps a lot. But again, I still did okay. I'll be right back again. My dog has to come back inside. Rest. So once I paid closer attention to the book, at the very end, I mean, you don't have to see it. At the very end, it states that there are online resources for that particular textbook. You know, some textbooks come with the access card and everything. Unfortunately, I bought mine used off of Amazon, so it didn't come with an access card. And I think this is kind of where, I mean, I'm going to be pretty blunt with it. I think this is where textbook companies really screw people, especially people who have visual impairments. So I bought this offline for, you know, a discounted price because it's used, which honestly, if it's okay with my parents, I probably won't do again. And I don't know if this is just because of my visual impairment or if it's because of my ADD or a combination of the both. But when other people highlight my book before I get a chance to highlight it, it gets kind of distracting because some of the things that they found important, I don't find important. So I don't know. Maybe I'll try and buy newer books more often if it's affordable. Here's what I'm saying, though. I bought the full textbook. Okay. It didn't come with the access code. And to buy just an access code is $140. So it's kind of terrible because, and not to mention, this is just a small rant about this company, and I'm sure other textbook companies do this too, but this is from C-Engage, or however you are supposed to say it. But not to mention, when you buy the $140 access code, you only have access to those resources for 180 days. I mean, it's a decent amount of time, but if you want to go back and reference it, I mean, this is going to be my career, and I like to have the material to reference back to in the future. So that's why I like to buy the physical copy, is so I can have it in the future if there's, you know, an issue that I run into with a client or something like that and I need to look it up, I'll have that. But that expires after 180 days online. So that's kind of annoying. But I will say, if you can't afford it, if it comes with a new textbook, it is very, very, very helpful to have. And this is why. It's not the same for everything, but this is why. It has a, I think it's called speak reader. So if I was having trouble staying focused because of my vision, I would turn on the speak reader. It's very robotic. It's not a very pleasant voice to listen to the whole time, but it definitely helps when my eyes are kind of lacking their power. So it has a speak reader on it, which is helpful. You're able to search the book for key terms. It comes with practice quizzes. It comes with note cards and a glossary. So it was really, really helpful for me to have, and I can't thank my parents enough for allowing me to have that resource. But again, it's not super affordable. And, you know, maybe at some point we should try and, I mean, I know right now I'm currently not able to do it, but if I could, we should, like, try to make a resource where we can have someone read textbooks. Maybe that exists. But again, a lot of the resources that are available for totally blind. But, I mean, I'm sure if you emailed the company and said, told them about your situation, they might be able to help you out. But, so that's something to consider. If your book has online resources, that's helpful to have. And that has helped me quite a bit. But it's, in this program anyway, it's kind of, it was difficult. It really was. I was kind of feeling downtrodden by it because it would take me all day to read a chapter because I was being so detailed with my notes and I was trying to study all of it and I just simply couldn't read it all. So, yeah. So that is definitely helpful to have. Yeah, I said audiobook resources are nice to have already. Okay. Again, I'm going to get into organization. If you are in an online program, it's pretty well known that it can be harder to stay on track with your assignments. And again, this is actually more for just the ADD part of me. So if you don't have ADD, just plug your ears and sing a song for a minute. But so for me, I wanted to make sure I could stay on track. I bought a really nice pretty binder, something that I would feel happy about using. Like, this is beautiful. So I love to open it up and use it. So this particular planner has, you know, your typical calendar and then a week by week rundown. So I'm able to plan out what I'm supposed to do each day. As I said, maybe breaking down some of the material in chunks might be a good idea. Like, if you're not ADD too, breaking it down in chunks is good because then you're not straining your eyes for a very long time. Like, for me, if I had a big, long book to read, I would read it chapter by chapter or a couple chapters a day. Currently, there's another book that I have to read. The writing in this one, first of all, it's just amazing, and I enjoy reading it. But also, thank goodness, like, I'm trying to look for an actual page here. The writing is much, much larger than the other book that I had to read. So it has the daily planning. And then, you know, for nice things, it has like a quote per day and like special notes. Let me see if I can try and show you this. So it has like special notes on the side and like water. So you can track your water. Like, this is for extra things. It says here, like, meals, exercise, inspiration. And then up here. This is a quote. So, anyway, it's really helpful and great. One of the things that I have to learn how to get better at, though, is planning for my self-care. So instead of just grinding at the schoolwork, I have to be better about taking care of myself and taking a little bit of time to relax and have fun as well. So staying organized is a big thing. Make sure maybe to break things down so you have a way of finding it easily, and then you don't have to strain your eyes so much with a big chunk of reading to do. Okay, so another really important thing with, it's a lot like on-campus learning, rather. Another big thing is make sure you stay in contact with your teachers. Even though you're online, it's a good thing to have contact with your teachers. Let them know if you're struggling. And I haven't had to do this yet, and I hope to not really have to, but originally, when I was planning on getting my cross-linking, it was supposed to be in the middle of my schoolwork, which wasn't really going to work out that well. But I knew that if that were to be the case and it were to continue as I had originally planned, that I would need to contact my teachers and let them know, like, hey, I might need some extensions on some of the assignments for my program. Again, it's going to be different for everyone. For my program, it's generally, I'm generally given 2 weeks to complete a few assignments. But, you know, so make sure you stay in contact with your teachers. Let them know what's up. Let them know if you're struggling. They are there to help you. So just stay in contact with them. I definitely, again, this goes back to my ADD. It works in tandem. So I had a professor for a chemistry class. Maybe it was biology. Actually, no, this was on campus. So I had a professor who was my literature professor, and I wrote, you know, a long final paper. And in the end, I forgot to send it in, I think, or didn't go through. And he emailed me about it. Thank God he told me. Otherwise, he could have just given me a zero. But he told me about it and said, oh my God, I'm so sorry. I had this written right for the due date. Like, I had it done, I promise. And he ended up giving me the full credit that he would have given me. So that was really nice of him. People are generally kind of understanding if you tell them what's up. So try to be real with people and they'll probably be real with you back. I mean, sometimes there's no exception. Like, I definitely did something similar for my grad school, where I completed the assignment before it was due, like probably half of a week before it was due, and I just spaced it and forgot to submit it, and I ended up getting like 80% taken off, which stinks, but that's the rule, you know, and I'm okay with that. I don't really want people to pity me. So I'm okay that I have to adhere to the rules. Rules shouldn't just be changed for me, you know. So to get into the learning styles a little bit. And I'm going to be so horribly annoying with this. So I had to research a psychologist, a pioneer of art therapy, for my grad school classes. And the person that I chose was Victor Lowenfeld. And he worked with blind students and visually impaired students, and he had a lot of research on it. So I should remember this. I mean, I know he had some of the books he had was Creative and Mental Growth, and what else? Creative and Mental Growth was the one that had a lot of information that I used. He also is known for developmental learning stages using artwork. So like the scribble stage is like the first stage, and he goes through like their kinesthetic movements and all of that. And he studies that with the blind. I want to kind of find his books here. Sorry, this might be very, very boring to people, but people might also find this interesting too. So he wrote Creative and Mental Growth, which I already said. I mean, he wrote, like, he was from Austria, so a lot of his, he has a couple books that aren't in. Anyway, I'm not going to go into a ton of detail because I don't want to bore you. It's interesting to me because I'm an artist and he worked with the blind with art therapy. So, and actually, I mean, it is art therapy, but at the time he was an art educator, I believe. He was introduced to it because of a mentor of his who said that, like, a true sculptor should sculpt with the senses and know how to sculpt with their eyes closed. And that's where he became interested in teaching the blind. So, I know a couple of his books are in German, I believe. I believe it's German. Yeah, it is, sorry. So, German, and one is The Sculpture of the Blind, and that was in combination with someone else, a co-author. Anyway, enough of the details, but basically what's really interesting is he did, one of his theories was about visual and spatial learning. Visual versus kinesthetic learning. Spatial learning is visual learning. Sorry about that. Visual and haptic. Haptic is like movement, and visual is obviously visual. People who are blind, sorry, I'm still kind of looking at this. I don't want to. People are blind or visually impaired. Okay, so haptic, here's the definition. Haptic is relating to the sense of touch, in particular relating to the perception and manipulation of objects using the senses of touch and proprioception, which is like pressure, I believe. Oh my god. Me getting brainy, sorry. If you wanted a glimpse into how I actually am, this is how I am. Oh, it's your relative positioning of neighboring parts. That makes sense. Okay, so I'm sorry for dorking out. All I'm trying to say is I'm curious about, like, the learning styles that you all have because we're visually impaired, we're not fully blind, and I know he worked with visually impaired too. I just question, like, I know for a fact visual perceptions and visual learning is probably not at the forefront of our abilities because of our impairment, but I'm interested in seeing, like, who has logical learning and who has intrapersonal and interpersonal. And I mean, that kind of has to do with more personalities because I'm an introvert, so I'd probably be more interpersonal rather than intrapersonal. And I'm curious to see, like, who benefits from what in their studies. So if you could leave it in the comments, maybe we can open up a discussion about it. And then I can maybe do another video about the discussion that we've had. I really do appreciate everyone's engagement with these videos in the comments. I really, really do love to write back to you, and I've been a little bit lacking on that just because I've been so busy, so I do apologize for that. But let me know if you're comfortable. You don't have to, but because I'm curious. I think maybe in my, you know, senior year or whatever I have to do for my thesis, maybe I'll do something about Keratoconus. It's just that might be a little bit hard to do, like with client contacts that isn't online. So I'm just curious because, again, it's rare. So certain studies aren't really done on people with keratoconus. They're just done with broad term visual impairments or blindness. So I kind of wanted to also brainstorm. Again, this is kind of a really casual, really lengthy video. I'm sorry. So I wanted to brainstorm with you guys some other options of what we could do to help with our studies, and that also relates to learning styles too. But I'm kind of curious of how we might be able to take the information we're learning and apply it to our particular learning styles to make learning a bit easier. And like some of the things that I've thought about is like maybe doing like recorded note cards. Like I'd have to be able to figure out how to do that, but do some sort of recorded note cards, or like for me, like sculpting something that represents the information I'm learning, doodling, drawing something that represents the information I'm learning might help, you know, pick it up. I'm kind of biased though. I mean, going into art therapy, so I'm biased towards creativity, but I think that using our creative senses kind of allows us to better visualize information in our mind. So acting out the content might be able to help. Do like a little bit of a video play. If you're intrapersonal, and you enjoy working with others to learn information, maybe you can get with your friends and classmates and do something like that to help everyone learn, because I mean that could benefit more people than just people with keratoconus. Yeah. So anyway, if you're interested and you kind of wanna, what's the word I'm looking for? If you wanna meditate on this, I guess if you wanna meditate on this and engage in a conversation, I would appreciate it because I would find it really interesting. Leave in the comments below what learning style that you think you are, and actually maybe I'll link down below like a test that you can take to figure out what learning style you are. And then once you know that, maybe we could all brainstorm together some ideas of how to apply that information to that type of learning style. All right. Okay. Thank you so much for watching. And I'm sorry this was such a lengthy, rambly video, but I know that I've had to figure this out along the way for myself, and I think it would have been beneficial if I had someone telling me what they did. So I'm hoping I can provide that for you. And I know I want to make a video on Careflex. I know one of my commenters mentioned it to me, and I totally spaced it and didn't get to mention it in the last video. So I want to make a video on the new procedure called Careflex, which is in a trial state right now. And then obviously I will be getting cross-linking soon, so I will make that video, you know, all of the videos I talked about in my last video. So again, thank you for watching, and I will see you next time. Bye.